Macmillan Audio presents Cabinet of Curiosities, a historical tour of the unbelievable, the unsettling, and the bizarre. Written by Aaron Mahnke with Harry Marks. Narrated by Aaron Mahnke, creator of the smash hit iHeartPodcast series, with guest appearances from Dana Schwartz. Introduction. We all have our favorite spot. Yours might be a bench that overlooks the ocean, shaded by twisted ancient trees. Perhaps it's a special restaurant you visit once a year, or maybe it's just a humble room in your family home. One of my favorite rooms in the world, if you're curious, is more than 3,000 miles from my office. That certainly makes it difficult to visit, I know. Despite that, not a week goes by that I don't close my eyes, if only for a moment, and revisit it in my imagination. The Enlightenment Room at the British Museum in London. There's a texture to the place that's difficult to describe. It's actually a number of connected rooms, grounded by beautiful wood flooring and lined on both sides by tall antique bookcases. Many of the shelves are used in the traditional sense, holding hundreds of old leather-bound volumes, but others serve as a display for a wide assortment of objects. It might be a national collection in one of the most prominent museums in the world, but it's impossible to not feel like you're also walking through someone's personal library. It is also, in a very real sense, a cabinet of curiosities. Want to feast your eyes on the magical equipment of one of England's most legendary wizards? The Elizabethan alchemist Dr. John Dee used a number of tools in his pursuit of forbidden knowledge, and some of them are on display in this magnificent room. His actual crystal ball shines under the lights, right beside a mirror crafted from polished black obsidian brought to England all the way from Mexico. There's even a magical disc about the size of a dinner plate, made of wax and covered in mysterious drawings, that looks like a prop from a Doctor Strange movie. How about a real mermaid from the 1700s? Of course, by real, I simply mean one of the many handmade taxidermy projects that combine the upper body of a monkey and the tail of a fish. They were typically made in Japan and passed off to gullible European visitors in exchange for money, of course. Most of us know about the Fiji mermaid that was part of P.T. Barnum's American Museum in New York City, but that specific example was only on display in 1842 and vanished shortly after in a fire. Thankfully, others still exist, and the Enlightenment Room is one place to get your fix. Now, when I call this space a cabinet of curiosities, I really do mean that literally. The practice of building a personal collection of curious objects goes back centuries, although it wasn't until the 1600s that they really started to take off in Europe. By the 1700s, the trend had spread even to England. These wonder rooms, as they were sometimes called, usually served two purposes. They offered a fun hobby for bored aristocrats to show off their wealth and well-traveled light fingers. Think of them as the private souvenir drawers of various European colonizers, with all the complex baggage that comes with that language. But they were also bold attempts by these people to understand the world around them. Every time they stumbled upon some weird part of nature, they would bring it home, study it, and then put it on display. They were curiosities because they raised questions rather than providing answers, and humans aren't very good at letting go of a mystery, are they? At this point, you might be thinking that these old wonder rooms and cabinets of curiosities sort of sound like museums, and you would be correct. In fact, a lot of European museums began as a gathering point of many personal collections. Over the years, these private cabinets were bought up, bequeathed, and donated until they became the large public collections that we call museums. In fact, the Enlightenment Room is the oldest in the British Museum. It originally held the King's Library, a collection of 65,000 books and documents gathered by King George III. And then, in 2003, the space reopened as the Cabinet of Curiosities it is today. A good chunk of the items you can see in there, as well as other objects across the museum, came from the personal collection of Sir Hans Sloane, who spent the better part of 7 decades gathering a staggering collection of over 71,000 pieces. In a very real way, the curiosity of one person led to the collection and preservation of an incredible amount of history. One last thing. If you had the chance to slowly walk the length of this gallery, you would notice how all of the objects are grouped into themed collections. Geological samples are in one spot, relics from specific scientific expeditions can be found elsewhere, and there are even collections of fossils and bones. The reason for this organization is pretty obvious. It helps visitors get a full experience. They can explore one particular category and really soak it in. Plus, seeing related items together on the shelf adds an extra layer of context to their individual stories. All of a sudden, they are more than just unique items. They become part of a bigger world. Which is why this book exists. My team and I have spent the past 5 years gathering the most amazing, entertaining, and enlightening stories from history and placing them into a modern digital cabinet of curiosities. Yes, every story is a little object sitting on a shelf by itself, and that's all well and good, but it's time for a bit of organization. Like the Enlightenment Room, my goal here is to present these tales in the context of specific categories. This topical arrangement allows fans of curious history to more easily find what they're looking for, and to see just how interconnected the individual stories of the past really are. So please, enjoy your tour through a new kind of cabinet of curiosities. Walk the width and length of our gallery and take in the wonders that are on display. I've worked hard to curate this ever-evolving exhibit of the most fascinating tales from history, and I'm certain that you'll enjoy visiting these incredible places, unusual characters, and amazing events. That is, of course, if you're more than a little curious. Aaron Mahnke, November 2023. Part 1. Curious Americana. Second Life. It's one of the many tales of the founding of America. Settlers from England were exploring more and more of the New World, and as they did, they set up new communities far from the comfort of home. We know these stories as well as the backs of our hands, if not in detail, then at least in theme. Most of the original states have a story that echoes these themes, but there's one tale in particular that I want to tell you. Some think it begins as far back as the late 1670s, when English settlers began to cross over the Appalachian Mountains. First, there were dozens, then hundreds, and then thousands. They made their homes in an area that was part of the far western edge of the colonies of North Carolina and Virginia, settling along the Watauga River Valley. They farmed and hunted for years, making a new life for themselves. But in 1763, England declared it to be illegal to cross the mountains into the West, so they had a choice: return to North Carolina's legal territory, or become united and support themselves. They had fought to be there, after all, defending themselves against the Cherokee tribe of Native Americans. They didn't want to give up on all of that. In 1772, they drafted a document that foreshadowed the coming Declaration of Independence. With it, they formed the Watauga Association, set up courts and a militia, and continued to defend their territory. A few years later, the British sent troops over the mountains to attack them, but these frontiersmen were stronger than they seemed. They met the British at the foot of King's Mountain and sent them retreating back into the eastern colonies. After the war was over, they tried their hand at being a satellite colony of North Carolina. But after being taxed almost as severely as they had under the crown, they seceded to go it alone. In 1784, they set up their own state, America's 14th, in fact, and elected a governor named John Sevier. Thomas Jefferson even backed their move and helped them make a formal request to the government to be recognized as a new American state. Sadly, the new state failed to get the approval necessary, and their entire enterprise fell apart. About 4 years after attempting to become an independent state, their lands were repossessed by North Carolina, and Sevier was arrested as a traitor, which is why you've never heard of the first 14th state in American history, a state named after one of the heroes of the Revolution, Benjamin Franklin. Yes, the state of Franklin was shut down before it could even begin its new official life, but the spirit that gave birth to it, the strength of the frontier settlers and their fierce independence, helped keep the dream alive. In 1796, 12 years after their first failure, the people of the territory were successfully admitted to the Union as a state. They changed the name from Franklin to Tennessee, and it's stuck ever since. Oh, and their first governor? None other than John Sevier, naturally. It's a powerful lesson, wrapped up in a bit of lost, bizarre history. Our failures often hurt, but over time, most people will forget about them. What's truly important, it seems, is to never give up. You never know how things will turn out in the end. Shots fired. Theodore Roosevelt is remembered today as an icon of strength, and for good reason. He was a cowboy, a hunter, and a soldier before he ever stepped foot in the White House. But not everyone knows the truth behind the bull moose's tough demeanor. Growing up, Teddy was sick. A lot. He battled asthma for most of his childhood and woke up many nights suffering from severe breathing problems, a feeling he compared to being smothered to death. As he got older, joining his father on hikes and camping trips, the attacks lessened. Teddy realized the secret to beating his asthma was in physically strengthening his body. He took up boxing and studied biology. Hunting became a beloved pastime, especially on his ranches in North Dakota. His resilience carried him through college, where he studied naval history and strategy, even as he worked his way up through the New York State Assembly, governor's office, vice presidency, and then, finally, the White House. Teddy had grand plans for his presidency, and one of those plans included an unprecedented third term in office. It was the fall of 1912 in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, when he left his hotel to deliver one of the last speeches of his grueling campaign. He'd been on the road for weeks, shaking hands and talking before crowds of hundreds, even thousands of voters at a time. His voice had all but disappeared, but Teddy pressed on. There were bigger issues at stake, and by this time, Teddy was known for speaking softly. Clad in his thick army overcoat, he stepped into a waiting car ready to whisk him off to the auditorium. Inside his breast pocket, Teddy had placed his folded-up speech, about 50 pages in total, and his metal eyeglasses case. A crowd cheered when they saw him, and Theodore Roosevelt, not one to disappoint his adoring constituents, stood to wave back at them. He never saw John Schrank, the out-of-work barkeep, raise the Colt 45 to his chest. The shot rang out, and Schrank was quickly tackled and arrested by Roosevelt's bodyguards. The would-be assassin claimed that the ghost of William McKinley had visited him in a dream one night and told him to avenge McKinley's assassination by killing President Roosevelt. Teddy, pale but calm, touched his fingers to his lips. If the bullet had pierced his lung, he would have blood coming out of his mouth. When his fingers came back clean, he instructed the driver to get him to the auditorium right away. Once there, three doctors examined the severity of the president's wound. The bullet had, in fact, pierced his skin and lodged itself in the right side of his chest. It had been slowed, though, by the thick wad of paper and the metal case in his pocket, so much so that the damage was only superficial. Teddy pressed on, determined to deliver this important speech. He sent one of his bodyguards out on stage to explain to the audience what had happened. Some of them, though, didn't buy it. One man shouted an all-too-familiar refrain, "Fake!" Teddy took to the stage, the blood-stained shirt on display for all to see. He held up the speech with the hole going straight through all 50 pages, and just like that, the crowd fell silent. He spoke for an hour and a half before finally heading to the hospital. Doctors were unable to remove the bullet, but Teddy lived on with it inside his chest for the rest of his life. His valiant efforts didn't win him any points with the voters, though. 1 month later, Woodrow Wilson won the election and became the 28th president of the United States. But Teddy wasn't fazed by the attempt on his life. He'd been expecting something like that to happen for a while. When asked how he was able to remain so calm and deliver his entire speech, even after being shot in the chest, this was his reply. In the very unlikely event of the wound being mortal, I wish to die with my boots on.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.